I'll tell you, the prayer time has been powerful. The worship time has been powerful. We're going to open up God's Word. I know that that will be powerful. Any chance we get to open up God's Word, God always shows up and He always teaches us something. Thank you for being here. It's a holiday weekend. You can be a lot of different places, and you chose to be in worship. And I'm thrilled that you're here. Today we are concluding our series called Unsung. And we've spent the past 3 months as we've been looking at everyday people who had an uncommon faith. And what I thought we might do, if you take a look at the top of your note page, I thought we might just kind of go back through some of those different sermons. And you'll see some words there, but you may not remember all of the different stories that were covered. We began with a relentless faith. A faith that would cause four friends to lower their lame friend through a roof in order to get him in front of Jesus. And then we talked about a reckless faith that motivated a woman to lunge in the midst of a crowd and to reach out. And she had this incurable disease, and she reached out and she touched the hem of Jesus' garment. She had such confidence that she would be healed. That's an incredible reckless faith. Then we talked about a reconciling faith. That was a faith that caused Barnabas to build a bridge with others. We looked at that in the book of Acts in the 9th chapter. And a redeeming faith that was expressed by a criminal as he hung on a cross right next to the one in whom he would end up putting his faith and trust before he expired and passed away. We talked about a risk-taking faith that allowed a prostitute to do something rather dangerous. She hid two men of God and basically saved them so that God's agenda could continue. A refreshing faith that allowed a woman who had had six guys in her life decide to put her faith in the seventh guy who came along, because that seventh guy personally revealed to her his deity at a town well. We looked at a responsive faith, a faith that caused a man to entrust his donkey to strangers, total strangers, so that Jesus could publicly declare his deity to everyone in Jerusalem. We learned about a respectful faith, a faith that motivated three soldiers to risk their lives for their king just to go and get him a drink from the town well at Bethlehem. And we looked at a rescuing faith that allowed that same king, King David, to reach out and care for the disabled son of the previous king, Saul. And now, today, we are going to discover a radical faith. And we're going to learn about this from a woman named Mary. And like all of these others, she displays an uncommon faith in Jesus Christ. So I want you to take your Bible out, if you would. I want to invite you to turn to John chapter 12. And we're going to walk through a passage of Scripture there. I love to hear those pages turning. John chapter 12. And this is a different Mary, in case you're not familiar with this story. You hear the name Mary. Well, this is not Mary, the mother of Jesus. This is not Mary, as in Mary Magdalene. This is Mary, who is Martha's sister, and she desperately wants to convey her love and appreciation for Jesus and let everyone know of her complete faith that she has in him. So rather than just telling Jesus that she loves him and that she has her faith in him, she attempts to show him, and she abandons putting her love into words, and instead she puts her love into action so that her radical faith would be both evident and obvious. And here's what we're going to discover today. It's simply this: a radical faith causes you to express your commitment in unconventional ways. Can't say exactly what that way might be for you, but I promise you this: you will have the opportunity throughout your life to express your faith and your commitment to Christ in very unconventional ways. Let's pick up the story in John chapter 12, verses 1 and 2. 6 days before the Passover, Jesus therefore came to Bethany, where Lazarus was, whom Jesus had raised from the dead. So they gave a dinner for him there. And Martha served, and Lazarus was one of those reclining with him at the table. So John 12 tells us that the setting is in Bethany. We take a look at some of the other gospel accounts, and we begin to find out a little bit more, some more specific details. We learn from Matthew's account that this was, the exact location was at Simon the leper's house, was where this banquet was held. The Bible gives us different details from the perspective of different gospel writers, and most people think that Simon was probably a close friend of Mary's, or perhaps he was the father of Mary and Martha and Lazarus. We don't know, but it's probable that he had been healed by Jesus. That's why he's referred to as Simon the leper. That's the only explanation for why a man afflicted with the disease of leprosy would be able to host a banquet in his own home, because typically those people were relegated and sent to a leper colony. So Jesus must have intervened with this man. And Simon is a common name. It would be like James or John today. And so it's tough for us to know all the specifics, but we do know this. There's a dinner that is given in Jesus' honor. But look what happens in the middle of the dinner. Look in your Bible at verse 3. Mary, therefore, took a pound of expensive ointment made from pure nard and anointed the feet of Jesus and wiped his feet with her hair. The house was filled with the fragrance of the perfume. So Mary anoints Jesus' feet with perfume. This is quite an outlandish gesture of appreciation. And so the first characteristic that she teaches us is this. A radical faith may involve a demonstrative display. It might. It doesn't have to, but at some particular point, it might manifest itself that way through some demonstrative display. I mean, why not just go off to the side and share some heartfelt words of appreciation with Jesus? Why not just do a little hand-scribbled note on a piece of parchment? Why not wait for Clergy Appreciation Month in October, you know? And give Jesus a Chick-fil-A gift card. And just say, hey, appreciate everything that you do, right? Well, why would she love Jesus so much that she would pour an expensive perfume on his dirty, smelly feet? Well, that's easy. Jesus had raised her brother Lazarus from the dead. And so she is trying to convey her love to Jesus. Sometimes when we do that, we communicate that through our words. I have a friend, his name's John Russell, and he and his wife Susan were out of town not too long ago. And when they were out of town, they were looking for a church while they were vacationing where they could worship. They came into the service a little bit late on that Sunday, and it was in the middle of the worship time. And the guy that was up front leading, everything was going fine. And about halfway through the worship time, this guy said, hey, today in our greeting time, rather than just saying hi and shaking hands with the person behind you or beside you, here's what I want you to do. He said, I want you to look him in the eyes and tell him, I love you. And John thought, oh, this is the hokiest thing I have ever heard in my life. He said, how manipulative that they would even cause us to do this. But about that time, he said, a young gal turned around and looked him square in the eyes, and he said she was one of the most beautiful women he'd ever seen in his life. And she looked right into John's eyes and said, I love you. And before John could say anything, John's wife, Susan, leaned over and said, we love you too. So while our commitment and our faith and love may be demonstrative at times, it shouldn't be misleading, all right? Here in John chapter 12, Mary doesn't use words. Instead, she approaches Jesus with a jar in her hand. And look at what Mary did after she broke that jar and began to pour this precious ointment over him. Look at what she did. She took the most honored part of her body in that culture, her hair, and she used it to clean the lowliest and the dirtiest part of Jesus' body, his feet. Remember earlier in Mark's gospel account, it tells us that this was at the home of Simon the leper in Matthew and Mark. There's much to celebrate if Jesus healed the host's leprosy and he brought Lazarus back from the dead. This would be quite a celebration. It certainly seems fitting to have a dinner in honor of the one who cured an incurable disease and who resurrected a dead man. But I want to make certain that you notice a couple of things that we'll miss if we just take a quick glance at this paragraph, because there's so many different things in this. First, the Bible tells us, John tells us that that house was filled with the fragrance of the perfume. So in other words, this wasn't some side room discussion. This was not just a discreet whisper. This was something that called everybody's attention. This demonstrative display, she is proud and perfectly happy to let the world know, for everyone to know, I love this man. I appreciate what he did for our family. And I will always be indebted to him. True love means that you go public. You don't care who finds out. You ever seen a gal when she gets engaged? You know, you never see her hand until she gets engaged. And the second she gets engaged, the next few days, she walks around like this, you know, constantly like that, talking to you. Right, right. And you say, oh, wait a second, is that a ring? Oh, I forgot. It's right here, right? And they put it right up there for you. See, why? Because they're proud, they're excited, they're bold. They want everybody to know that I love this person, that I've been chosen. And with Mary, if they didn't hear any sobs of appreciation from all corners of the house, which they probably did, then they were drawn to the fragrant, overwhelming smell of this precious ointment, and it attracted the attention of everyone who was there. But also notice that for Mary to wipe his feet with her hair had to be unbound. You say, okay, thank you, Detective Dave. I appreciate that update, right? Well, there's more to it. You see, a Jewish woman was not allowed to come out in public in front of men unless it was her husband, and it was one man, with her hair unbound. But her love and gratitude for Jesus was stronger than any Jewish tradition. And so she wanted everyone to know. And Mary's faith in Christ and love for Christ was stronger than any Jewish tradition. Cal Thomas says it like this. He says, love talked about is easily ignored, but love demonstrated is irresistible. And he's right. The second characteristic that Mary shows us is that a radical faith is willing to pay any price. I mean, everybody likes to receive gifts. How many of y'all like to give gifts? Let me ask you that. Just put your hand up at all of our campuses. If you like to give gifts, now pay attention. Keep those hands up. Pay attention, all right, to the people who have those hands up. Just in case you need something, those are good hands to go back to. You can put them down now. Now, the price is usually secondary to the purpose of the gift. If you like to give gifts, you can justify spending as much as you want. All that matters is the purpose of the gift. Does it serve its purpose? And a radical faith is willing to pay any price. And Mary shows us that. Now, several years ago, when I was turning 50, I got really excited because I knew my birthday was coming, and I know my wife likes to give good gifts. And so, I mean, she's not one of these gals that just, you know, goes up to the 7-Eleven and finds something for me. I mean, she puts some thought into this. Not that there's anything wrong with the 7-Eleven. But she puts some thought into this. And in my mind, I'm thinking, you know what? This is the 50th birthday. There is no telling what she's got me. So I kept waiting and waiting. One day before my birthday, I came home. She meets me at the door. She is chomping at the bit. She is smiling. She said, You ready? I said, ready for what? She said, I got your birthday gift. You're going to get it today. I've got it all planned out for you. And I'm like, planned out? What do you mean? She said, we got to be over on Shelbyville Road in 15 minutes. So we got to get back in the car and we got to head out right now. And she was so excited. And I said, really? Well, what is it? And she said, Dave, for your 50th birthday, I have got you scheduled for a back waxing. And she said it with such excitement, and she was smiling so big, and I didn't know what a back waxing was. And so I just kept smiling really big. I said, oh, wow, that's great. That sounds really cool. And I just had no idea. I do now. So we go to the store, and she comes walking in, and I could tell she'd been there before, and all these people just kind of nodded at her, and she started heading me toward the back with some other little lady. And everybody that I walked past, they were all these ladies. They were sitting in these big, fluffy chairs that were massaging their backs, and their feet were right there in hot water, and ladies were down on the ground. They were rubbing their feet, and I thought, man alive, have I died and gone to heaven? this is going to be incredible. But they took me to this back room and they shut the door and they said, take your shirt off and lay down on top of the padded table. And I'm thinking, okay, a back waxing. This gal is going to take a giant candle and she's going to roll it gently over my back. And she's going to do this back and forth until I fall asleep for like 30 minutes. And I'm like, whoa, this is the greatest gift I've ever gotten. I just didn't understand. But my first clue was when I was face down, my wife came over and she said to me, do you want to hold my hand? And that was a tip off for me. But nothing could have prepared me for what happened next. The sweet little woman, who I thought was a Christian, began to pour burning hot lava on a small section of my back. I would have screamed, but the pain had taken my breath away. And just at the instant that the scalding wax began to cool and my body had stopped convulsing, this woman, with the gusto of a steel worker, emphatically ripped off a field of hair follicles, and she continued this across my entire back for the next 20 minutes. I mean, I was in such pain. And the entire time, my face was face down, but I sensed in my mind that the two women were smiling at each other. Somebody asked me the next day, hey, what'd you get for your 50th? I said, I got a back waxing. He said, what had you done to your wife? So when I'm about to turn 60 in a few years, I'm telling you right now, I'm just going to take the easy way out, and I'm just going to pray. I'm going to pray that God sends me a kidney stone. That'll be easier, okay? Now, I don't know how much that birthday gift cost Beth, but I promise you it cost me more. And when I walked in that store, everything seemed great. But oh, how quickly everything changed. And when Mary was giving this unselfish gift to Jesus, everything seemed so great. But oh, how quickly things changed. And in her setting, it went from hopeful to hopeless in just a matter of seconds. Do you know why? Judas spoke up. And Judas says, hey, man, this money should have been given to the poor. We could have sold that precious ointment. We could have had that money and we could have given that to the poor. He said, what a waste. And 2,000 years later, we can still hear the self-righteousness in his voice. So let's step through this one line at a time. Look back with me at John chapter 12. We'll see just how much Mary's gift cost her. John chapter 12, pick it up with verse 4 through 6. Verse 4, but Judas Iscariot, one of his disciples, he who was about to betray him. Stop right there for just a second. John would be a terrible movie producer. He's telling us the end of the story before it even has happened. He's not going to betray Jesus for another week, but he just wants to make certain that you know. John is always sliding things in, little details that beg for your attention, so that you will be able to stay pulled in with what it is that he wants you to notice. And so he says, hey, he's going to later betray Jesus. You need to know that this guy's a jerk, is what he's basically saying. Listen to what Judas Iscariot says. Look at verse 5. Why was this ointment not sold for 300 denarii and given to the poor? He said this not because he cared about the poor, but because he was a thief. And having charge of the money bag, he used to help himself to what was put into it. That's what's going on here. Now, it's interesting because Matthew and Mark's account, they tell us that the disciples all murmured about this. And the disciples all said, you know, why wasn't this perfume sold and the money given to the poor? But John gives us more detail, and John tells us who the instigator was. It was Judas. Judas just is the one who started it. And he was so credible among the disciples that when he said it, they all joined in. Yes, yes, yes. But John reveals his motives and says, why is he saying this? Because as keeper of the money bag, he used to dip into it sometimes. And in Judas's mind, the more he has there, the easier it will be to skim some off of it for him. Now, Judas starts the complaining and says that it was worth a year's salary. Back then, a day's wage would be a denarius. And if you take the Sabbath day out, then that comes down to around 300 days. So 300 denarii is what this particular ointment was worth. This is some potent and pricey perfume, right? And the book of Exodus tells us that these perfumes and ointments were usually kept in an alabaster jar. And most theologians think that this was probably a family inheritance, a container that had been passed down from generation to generation. How do you put a price tag on your brother's resurrection? It's impossible to quantify such a miracle. So you would pay anything, you would give anything for your loved one to have life. And she follows that inner urging from within, and what appears to be a display of waste on closer investigation isn't wasteful at all. In fact, it's true worship. And when you feel compelled to do something positive or encouraging for others, when you feel called to make a difference in someone else's life, I just want to challenge you to listen to God's Spirit and to go for it. And it might seem unconventional, but go for it anyway. Write this down. Follow through when you sense that the Spirit of God prompts you to encourage others, no matter how radical it may seem. And it will seem radical sometimes. But will you step up to the plate? Will you go for it? Back in the 1950s, there was a woman who was out of town for a couple of days. She sent a telegram back to her husband to get permission to purchase an expensive antique. Later that day, he sent a telegram back to her with his reply. And after reading the reply, she bought the antique. And when she arrived home and came walking in the door with the antique, her husband said, what are you doing? Didn't you get the telegram? And she said, oh, yes, I got the telegram. Thank you so much. You have to understand, telegrams were usually void of punctuation. You know why? You paid by the character. And so you would make shortcuts by not putting punctuation in because you were paying for that punctuation. And so he intended his message to read one way, and yet it was understood another way. This is what he sent to her. No, price too high. But she had been encouraged by what he'd written because she read it as no price too high. In other words, anything for my little buttercup. Whatever she wants, there's no price too high. What a difference a comma makes. Now, can I tell you something? At that dinner 2,000 years ago, Mary's assessment and what Mary was communicating to Jesus was this: no price too high. No price too high. He raised my brother from the dead. Our lives will never be the same again. Our family will be forever marked by your power and your kindness. And today in 2019, when you have come face to face with Jesus Christ through his word and through his Spirit and through his people, you'll never be the same again. And your service and your giving begins to flow, and it just becomes a part of who you are. It's an outgrowth of who you are. It becomes a way to express your radical faith in a radical Savior. Corrie Ten Boom survived the Holocaust and has an incredible Christian testimony, but she once wrote these words. She said, I have learned to hold all things loosely so God will not have to pry them out of my hands. It's a good lesson for all of us to learn. And while Mary may have planned what she would give to Jesus, she may not have thought about how she would give it to Jesus. And perhaps she brought this alabaster jar and she thought, you know, sometime tonight, at the dinner sometime, I'm just going to walk up, I'm just going to give it to him, and I'm going to have, you know, Martha beside me and Lazarus beside me because this is from our family. I'm just going to give it to him and say, hey, this means a whole lot. It's been in our family for so many years. We just want you to know how much we love you and give it to him. So maybe that was her plan. But then perhaps she saw Jesus at the dinner, talking with her brother Lazarus. And in her mind, she quickly rewound to the last time Jesus had come to that house, and she was grieving over his death. He'd been buried for 4 days when Jesus arrived. And so now she's seeing Jesus and Lazarus have a conversation, something that before she never thought would happen ever again. And she's overcome with emotion. And so instantly and impulsively, she just breaks the neck of the jar and she pours the contents all over him. Matthew and Mark said that she poured it on his head. John points out the fact that she poured it on his feet. Well, obviously he did both, all the way from the tip of his head to the bottom of his feet. And John is so drawn to the fact that she takes her hair and wipes it on his dirty feet, that he wants to drive that home for us. You've got the picture. But if she had planned to do it this way when she brought the alabaster jar from home, if she would have planned to have done it that way, she would have brought a towel. That's what makes me think that it was just a spontaneous expression. And that's why she had to use her long hair to wipe the ointment all over his feet and ankles. Can you picture that scene in your mind? Can you see it as she rubbed her hair over his dirty feet? And she may as well have been doing sign language for no price too high, no price too high. And Jesus, who never sought the spotlight, sits there with all eyes focused on him. What is he going to do? And he humbles himself, and Jesus accepts the gift. That's not always easy to do. But in her mind, a significant miracle deserved a significant thank you. And so Jesus let her do this. He allowed it, even though he knew that he would have to defend both his actions and hers. She breaks the alabaster jar. She pours it all over Jesus' feet. Now, you could make a case for the fact that Jesus could have at that point or should have said, oh, wait, hey, don't break that thing. Because once you break that neck, this is not a resealable thing. This is only 32 or 33 AD, right? Once you break it, it's one and done. You're all in, okay? Or maybe he says, hey, you know what, let's pour some of it in another container. Let's do that. I appreciate what you're doing. That's very kind of you. Thank you. But let's save some of it for some other people sometime too. He could have done any of those things. He could have said, don't make such a big extravagant display about me here. I mean, you know, I know I raised your brother from the dead, but let's not make a big deal about it. He could have said any of those things. But he allows her to do it. And in so doing, he sets an example for us of how it is that we must learn to accept generosity and service and gratitude from other people. I want you to look back in your Bible at verse 7 because you're about to see what the Prince of Peace says to the crowd. The tide has totally turned now, okay? Everything was looking good at first. It was like, wow, I can't believe that this woman is doing this. And it was a positive thing. But then Judas speaks up, the disciples join in, and all of a sudden the mood has changed, and she's a villain. Jesus speaks for the first time, verse 7. Jesus said, leave her alone. Leave her alone, so that she may keep it for the day of my burial. For the poor you always have with you, but you do not always have me. Is that astounding? You talk about an unexpected response. What about diplomacy? What about practicality? What about the fact that this is a woman and she has made a public scene with a man who she is not married to? And yet Jesus says, leave her alone. Hey, our Savior will always defend his followers when their love is genuine, their generosity is evident, and their faith is radical. And nothing has changed about that in 2,000 years. And Jesus knew what was about to happen in the next week of his life, and so this would be the last opportunity prior to his death for them all to be together and for her to be able to give this gift. Here's the third takeaway for you. A radical faith keeps the focus on Jesus. A radical faith keeps the focus on Jesus. Jesus isn't against helping the poor. He loved the poor. He spent a great deal of time with the poor. He was poor. But Jesus knew Judas' motives, and helping the poor was merely a smokescreen. He just wanted some more money for himself. And so Jesus looks at them and says, hey, You'll always have the poor among you, but you won't always have me. Because a week later, he will have died a horrific death on a cross. And Jesus knows the time is right for Mary to show this love and appreciation. So Jesus commends Mary's radical faith because there was a deep purpose behind it. And whether it was spontaneous or not, I don't know. But I do know this, it was heartfelt. It was not haphazard. And those are the gifts that mean the most to us, aren't they? Even if they are spontaneous. About a month ago, I shared with you in a sermon that I had a granddad who could be rather selfish when it came to money and possessions. And during that particular season in his life, he was in a pattern of making some very unwise choices and selfish choices. Back in the 1980s, a couple of years after my grandmother passed away, my granddad decided that he would take all of the farm equipment, he would take all of my grandmother's belongings, and he would sell them at a public auction in order to provide some cash for some things that he wanted. And wise people tried to talk some sense into him, but nothing would dissuade him. And as you can imagine, the day of the auction was very emotional for the entire town, as here was family furniture, and here were household goods, and here were grandma's collections that were displayed. And I later learned that my grandfather's five adult children were given no chance to purchase items beforehand, even those of sentimental value. And I vividly remember watching my uncle at the time, who was in his 40s, as they rolled out a red wagon that was all rusted, but it had his name written on the side where he had painted it. And he had to go through and bid for his own red wagon. One of the family keepsakes that my mom was quite interested in was a beautiful wedding ring design handmade quilt. And since my grandmother had loved that quilt, my mom really wanted that to stay in our family. However, a very determined antique dealer wanted to purchase it so that he could resell it. And through the course of time and the bidding going back and forth, it reached a point that went beyond my mom's self-imposed spending limit. And it was just more than she could bear, the whole situation. And so she just withdrew from the bidding. And I'll never forget, she was overcome by emotion and wounded by her father's insensitivity. And she just got up from the barn and she just walked out. And the auctioneer continued to watch the bids go higher and higher. But several minutes later, a strange scene began to unfold. As my older brother, Jeff, who was a dirt poor preacher in his mid-20s, who had absolutely no money and no earthly interest in quilts, began bidding. And the bidding went higher and higher. And several minutes later, the auctioneer announced sold. And they folded up Jeff's purchase, and he walked outside the barn and he found my mom. And he gave it to her and he said, "I love you." And they hugged and we cried. Years later, my brother would say that I spent more than I really had. I paid more than I probably should have, but I've never regretted buying that quilt. Sometimes, like it was with Mary and with Jeff, it's just that spontaneous act of obedience when you know and you feel the Holy Spirit prompting you to take a radical step of faith and let the world know where you stand. Maybe for you, it's giving your life to Jesus Christ for the very first time. You've never done that. And you are here at the invitation of a friend, or maybe you've been investigating Christianity. And it's time for you just to accept his free gift of salvation that he's made available to you. Maybe for you, the spontaneous next step is just humbling yourself and being immersed into Christ. I mean, you've thought about baptism for quite some time. You've talked about it. You've read what God's word has to say about it. Now it's just time for you to do it. Maybe for you, it's a fall starts. It's deciding to say, you know what? I need to be in community. I believe that we're stronger when we are together than when we are apart. And although it's a little uncomfortable for me, it's out of my comfort zone a little bit, I'm going to check into a small group at Harvest, and I'm going to give it a try for 6 weeks and just get in community with others. Maybe for you, the spontaneous act is just sharing your faith. And when you usually fearfully clam up, instead, the next time you're in that situation, you're going to boldly speak up. Maybe for you, it's going to be growing in your faith by using your gifts and by serving the church and serving the Lord. Maybe it's going to be by growing in your generosity and the giving of your gifts. And maybe you've never tithed in your life and you say, okay, Lord, I'm going to do this spontaneous act and I'm just going to see how you provide for us. Maybe Mary's story inspires you to grow in one of those areas. I don't know. I've read this story in John 12 countless times, and I noticed something that I'd never noticed before, and that was that Mary didn't take that alabaster jar and pour it on her brother when he passed away a few weeks before. She could have. Would have been a good time to bring it down, pass from generation to generation. I don't know why she didn't. It stood out to Jesus. Jesus points it out in the one statement that he says. He says, but she saved this for my burial, because he knew what was about to happen. Sometimes when we talk about what we give back to the Lord, I think it confuses people. I mean, we can see what happened when Mark's gospel account says she broke this alabaster jar and poured out everything that was inside unto Jesus. This jar was worth a year's wages, broken in two just to show love. We know how much it cost Mary to show her love to Jesus. We know how much it cost Jesus to show his love for us. But the question becomes, what's it going to cost you? And here's the price tag. The psalmist talks about it. The Old Testament, in Psalm 51, verses 15 through 17. Listen to this. King David talks about what it's going to cost. He says, O Lord, open my lips, and my mouth will declare your praise. For you will not delight in sacrifice, or I would give it. You will not be pleased with the burnt offering. The sacrifices of God are a broken spirit and a broken and contrite heart, O God. You will not despise. Sometimes outsiders to faith think all God wants or all the church wants is my money. But here's what he wants. He wants you. He wants you. Jesus wants your broken spirit and broken heart more than a broken jar. He wants the contents of what's inside of you. He is eternally interested in what's in your heart. There's no need to pretend. You don't have to act like you have it all together to accept Jesus. In fact, that's a prerequisite. You can't have it all together. You can't be perfect. So we're all candidates for God's amazing grace. We're a colossal collection of imperfect people, imperfect members and leaders. And we're striving to be everyday people with an uncommon faith. And I'm here to tell you that you will find purpose when you go public with your priceless faith. That's when everything will change. You will find purpose in your life when you go public with your priceless faith. It's not something that you just keep to yourself. Your life will take on a deeper meaning when you decide that you will no longer keep your faith to yourself, but you begin to share it regardless of the cost. So to conclude this series, I want you to take a look at all of the titles of these past sermons that we've talked about. Because I imagine that there's some area of your faith that could use some growth. And as you look at that list up there, you see all of those different words. You take a look at them and you say, what might it be for me right now? What is it that I'm desperate for that I have to grow in? What is God saying to me? So I just want you to pray silently for about 20 or 30 seconds. Feel free to keep your eyes open and to look at these lists. And you say, okay, Lord, how do you want to manifest this? How do you want me to grow in this particular area? Let's pray silently. Lord, we look at this list and I just have to narrow it down to one. I could grow in a whole lot of these areas that are up there. But Lord, would you help us to center and focus on one that in the days ahead that we can take steps of faith in that particular area? And whatever it might be, Lord, you've laid it on our heart for a reason. And because of that, you will give us opportunities to stretch that muscle and to rely upon you and not ourselves. So this week, as we strive to walk by faith and not by sight, as we strive to live by the Spirit and not in the flesh, will you help our faith to grow and to soar as we seek to grow and have an uncommon faith? It's in the powerful name of Jesus that we pray.